And welcome back to the 2015 League of Legends World Championship. I'm Julian Pastrytime Carr, excited to bring you our next three games alongside Mitch Klipper Fortbos and Sam Kovey Hartman Kensler.
Should be a good one here. EDG going to come into their second game here in the group stages, and I'm very excited to see what they can do with it.
I'm just excited somebody can finally pronounce my name.
I tried very hard, so I'm glad we nailed that one, but we're going to set up our next game, and we have another chance for an underdog to make a stand. It is Europe's H2K versus China's Edward Gaming. Straight out of the gate, Edward Gaming were playing exactly the way we've come to expect them and forced the Bangkok Titans into a quick 20-minute surrender. So this one is going to be a bit tough.
You say underdog. All I see is that Europe's beating China so far in the tournament, so if history repeats itself. But yeah, getting back to the game, what I fear the most is this top lane triangle. So you have Klilov, Pawn, and Amazing J working together, and they should be able to beat Lulix, Ryu, and Odolamne. On paper, that matchup is so tilted towards Edward Gaming, so that alone should be very interesting to watch.
I guess, and the other side as well, like, just the supports are so strong there, so there might even be a mismatch, and in general, I feel like HDK are a little bit more on the bottom lane.
Yeah, having Lulix and Kasing, who were notoriously have been a little bit behind in terms of synergy, matchup against, yeah, Klilov and Mako, that is just not going to work out. So these are already a couple of mismatches we see, so it's very hard for us to find winning lanes, winning matchups, winning pairings altogether, so yeah, EDG definitely favorite over here.
Well, HDK is an all or nothing team that relies on getting that early game advantage. They weren't able to find it against SKT, and it won't be any easier today against Edward Gaming's faster and more aggressive game.
That's right. As you guys said, they are the underdogs coming into this one. To survive the EDG onslaught, it's going to be important for them to start out with a good jungle start for Lulix. You guys keep mentioning him. You know, against SKT, Bangi
really
just
well.
Came in, he bullied him out from the very beginning of
almost
the game.
Almost too easy.
Didn't even need his laners to collapse to come bully Lulix out. Wasn't able to even drop any defensive wards, so that's where it really went wrong very early for them. Also, H2K are going to have to watch out for the early dragon fights. We saw, you know, they were even able to claw their way sort of back into the game, and yet at that dragon fight, they kind of chased a little bit too much tunnel vision for them, and they got pretty far behind in the mid game.
I mean, it is so easy to get just overly excited when you are the underdog, when you're pitched to really lose that game and you somehow get a bit of a lead or you're winning a fight. You think, oh my god, we're doing this, this is going to happen, and then you chase too far. And then,
yeah.
You get
speaking him. Of Lulix, he was the one
he
with
was?
A good Gragas play, you know, and he ulted Faker back into the team fight, and that's what, you know, got their blood boiling, got them pumped up and wanting to chase, but a little bit too far.
Yeah, it was a bit, but before we hit the rift, I'm going to check out our stars. We'll start on the European LCS H2K's side. In the top lane, it is Odoamne. In the jungle, it is Lulix. In the mid, it is Ryu, AD carry Hyun, and support Kasing, and of course, Coach Proly.
Yeah, I wonder if they will actually give him Zed this time around. Probably he wasn't able to let Ryu lock it in before. But that's going to be it for H2K. For the LPL's Edward Gaming, it's going to be up top, Amazing J in the jungle, Clear Love. Mid Pawn, AD carry Deft, and of course support Mako. Coach Aaron is going to be on stage with them as well.
Yeah, there's just so much experience in that roster, both coaching staff and players. Like, they've been on this stage before. Even if H2K managed to get somewhat of a lead, an upset in the early game, these guys are resilient enough. They've played so many games over in the LPL, so not many things faze EDG.
Yeah, Aaron's got to be one of the most successful coaches in League of Legends of all time.
Absolutely, and I think the nice thing about this matchup is no matter what, EDG do like to punish you early. They can play different styles, but they prefer being proactive. And HDK, we already know, they're really coming out of the gate swinging team. So we could have a very fun, very chaotic game, especially in the early stages.
Yeah, I'm quite excited to see if HDK can keep pace up in the early game, because they have had, you know, strong showings in the early game. You know, throughout the European LCS, you guys talked about their lane swap a lot in the early stages, you know, in spring and something like that.
Yeah, so HDK have gone through different phases. Some part of the season where they were incredibly strong, 0 to 10, so they just had really good laning phases. But obviously, to do that against a team of EDG's caliber, relying on that strength, probably not the best strategy. But they were also just really good at the start of summer, especially in lane swaps, in the Western style lane swap, which is actually one of the more successful lane swap styles so far in the early stages of the tournament. However, they didn't have a plan B, so whenever one of their scripted moves kind of just fell flat and people started defending against very often these dives that Odoamne came down for, then HDK was kind of lost, and we could see that in their play, just not very, yeah, together, not in synergy.
Well, we are in a champs right now for this game. H2K over on the blue side, EDG on the red. Twisted Fate going to be banned away from Pawn, and Gangplank continues his very bannable status in this particular tournament.
Yeah, as we mentioned yesterday, Twisted Fate is one of the main champions that Edward Gaming have used to just steamroll in the past when they do get an early lead and Pawn just all over the map. So again, that's going to be banned away from them.
Yeah, that Twisted Fate ban seems to be only targeted at the Pawn in this tournament, so a very player-specific ban rather than a lot of what we see is like what we call meta bans, like Gangplank being banned out, Elise being banned out. You can see that for any team. Pawn TF, different case.
What was even more impressive was that yesterday it was banned against them from the red side, so they didn't even want to try and counter it and, you know, let them pick it early on the blue side and then go for something that could pressure him. But this time around, Prawly's taking the helm.
Yep, gonna make sure that's banned out there. Elise also banned by HDK, and Lee seen the response from Edward Gaming, so some of these top tier junglers actually getting taken out now.
Immediately springing to mind is again the Gragas that Lulex used yesterday. I think that HDK will probably prioritize that fairly heavily. Elise and Lee Sin being off the board are the top two super early game junglers.
And Lulu, most notably, actually gets open. Mordekaiser been 100% banned still, I believe, and thrashes Edward Gaming's final ban.
Lulu's been perma-ban status so long that it feels like some of these teams may just not even have the Lulu strategy on point, and then the enemy team is using that to bait them into early picking and hoping that their strategy isn't that well executed, and then they can get more OP picks in return. Let's see if H2K fall for this trap, or if they actually just get Lulu and win.
Yeah, so, well, Lulu is up, and then there is also the option of getting one of those Juggernauts in the top lane. So you don't want to just have the Lulu plus AD carry. Darius up in the top lanes, another great Lulu target for a lot of the buffs that she'll give up. So EDG not going to let them have that combo, it looks like, hovering over the Darius already. They want to split it up.
Yeah, it looks like Clearlove's looking at Rek'Sai here. Obviously, that pick goes up in value if Elise and Lee Sin are banned, and Clearlove obviously
He's got so many games on Rek'Sai.
Yeah, I think it's probably his best champion. So, I mean, maybe going to trade Rek'Sai for Gragas here, but Lulu was, of course, the first pick for HDK. Edward Gaming just deciding what they want to do with their next few picks. Lots of flexibility. They'll lock in Rek'Sai and Darius once again for Amazing J.
And here we see EDG wanting almost three picks and only having two slots available to them, so they have to let the Braum go, or the Braum could be an elaborate hover bait, but I doubt it. I think Braum is definitely pick worthy on the first rotation on purple, but so is Darius, so is Rek'Sai. So many choices open here in this champ select.
Yeah, the Unbreakable just provides so much value when you are facing a Lulu buffed AD carry to buy that amount of time in a team fight where you can block out so much range damage.
Yeah, we saw it yesterday. Unbreakable can just instantly deny Lulu's Q through the wave clear, and suddenly that tower that was not open for siege suddenly is available to be taken down by merit of the support player.
And remember, they banned Kasing's Thresh here as well. He's a very proficient Thresh player, so Mako can have fewer options depending on what H2K wants to go for here in the draft. See a lot of different hovers. Lulex really flipping through the champions, does settle on Gragas and Braum.
Yeah, I think it's pretty funny actually. Both the junglers were kind of planning on those two anyway, and they just missed paths anyway, ended up with what they wanted.
H2K haven't really given away too much information yet in this draft. Lulu first pick is expected by Edward Gaming, and then a generic tank jungler plus a Braum support. This is a very, yeah, patch meta draft so far.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they are saving the solo lane picks here for H2K, but top lane's already been shown for Edward, and I do not expect Edward to early pick their mid lane, even though they are hovering over Yasuo right now. I would expect them to do the bottom lane double lock-in and just save Pawn for the counter pick. You don't want to give away your mid lane counter pick for free.
No, I like that they're at least, you know, maybe showing something. Hey, this is a threat that we can bring out. Kalista was also left open. That's a hover now for EDG, and Deft and Imp actually, both from the LPL, been very proficient on that champion.
Kalista Cannon is one of the more brutal lanes in bot lane. Not only is Kalista just so good at trading, having a range support with that, any range support with some CC like Cannon or even Annie in this case.
Holds true.
You just keep talking until they walk something in. It's just so really hard to deal with. Yes, Braum has Unbreakable, but you're playing against double ranged with a CC component. And we saw what Mythi could do on that Annie, especially when you have Kalista to pull him out of sticky situations and throw him back in the enemy team.
And it's hard to say if it's Mako's best champion, but it might be his most famous on Annie. So Annie Kalista, the bot lane there for EDG, is H2K. Consider their final two picks of this draft. Seen a lot of zillion hovers for whatever reason in the tournament. Don't expect HDK to be taking that one.
Yeah, this is going to be fairly difficult for them. Ryu, last game yesterday, he was able to get the counter pick to try and get some carry potential for his team, but he's going to have to blind here, go a little bit safer, and be very wary of Pawn, because Pawn can play so many different champions in the mid lane, and he just utilizes counterpicks so well.
Yeah, just about anything there, and EDG have left the counterpick open, so we'll see with 3 seconds left. They do swap away from the Zillion. It seems like it will in fact be Tristana and Fiora as our last two H2K picks.
Obviously means that Lulu is going back to the mid lane. We were thinking about H2K, what do they need to fulfill this composition? More damage, because a one-dimensional Lulu composition kind of runs out of steam towards the late game. Now you have a lot of damage, but both of the damage sources are physical.
Yeah, it's actually pretty interesting, the Fiora-Darius matchup now, because yes, Fiora does have mobility and you can try and outplay the Darius Q to get either inside or outside of the blade. But with the reduced base stats for Fiora, just the toe-to-toe combat gets even more difficult. If you go straight into Darius and try and get inside the axe, he still stacks up bleeds on you, and he could just overpower you that way.
The biggest advantage in that matchup is that Darius's Q is incredibly telegraphed, so it should be an easy riposte for Fiora. However, then you're standing still, your defensive tool has been used, and that we've actually seen that being able used to be baiting. So you riposte the Q from Darius, and then the jungler comes in and kills you, so
yeah,
very
I definitely
weird.
Think this is a pretty skill match, pretty heavy skill matchup.
Certainly indeed, but Pwn has picked a very famous champion for himself with Super Saiyan in a quarterfinal to carry his team all the way through to a eventual win. It is Pwn's Kassadin.
Very low on wave clear though here on EDG. That's why we see a lot of these teams that come out swinging, confident that they're going to win, but they don't take into effect the possibility that they could actually get behind in the early game, and then suddenly without wave clear, things get rough.
Exactly. The wave clear has been a really big problem with teams that have been trying to get their hands on juggernauts really early. So your top lane, you know, is going to be a juggernaut, isn't going to be able to help much with that. So if these teams get behind, then they start to bleed turrets very early, and the global gold that your opponent's going to acquire can sometimes be enough to overpower you in that mid game.
H2K here, rounding up that composition, they do have the tools to deal with a lot of the threats from EDG. They can kite the Darius, they can stun lock the Kassadin. One of the issues with Kassadin is he jumps in, then he has the mobility to go out. Braum passive being able to be applied on multiple members of the EDG lineup could be crucial for H2K to potentially challenge EDG in this game.
Also, this bottom lane can be explosive. Like, this is a very, very dangerous bottom lane for whichever team gets the early pressure from either jungler or from top lane teleports. Any sort of influence on bottom lane is going to result in a blood.
Even just 2v2, I love aggressive jumps from a Tristana or a Braum in this matchup once any cooldowns are down. You know, any or Killista, you use a Q, use a Rend wrong. It's just an aggressive jump because Braum can jump after block unbreakable, and suddenly this matchup is just so different.
Well, as we get into the game, tweet at LOL Esports and let us know who you think is going to arise in groups. We've given you some of our thoughts, but use the hashtag H2KWin or EDGWin, and we'll see who you think has the edge in this particular matchup. Going to be tough. EDG likely coming at least somewhat favored, but H2K, a team that can certainly bring it. And if they're going to bring it, it's going to be nice and bloody in the early game.
Definitely agree. Especially that bottom lane matchup that you're talking to. So let's jump on the Rift and see about this early game. Will we get some deep wards scouting for any sort of lane swap, or will we actually get to see the 2v2 even matchups? H2K up on the top side of the map here.
And we've seen, I think, a big importance on lane swaps here. Never mind the lane.
Going
straight for it. We have a big invade. 5v5. Is this going to happen? No vision here. They're only a clear. Actually, got spotted at him. Huge stun there onto Lulex. Amazing J, though, gets absolutely matched by all the damage. Clear up. Going to get a knock up on the Cassine. They're going to keep running his death. He's hopping. He doesn't have that much damage, but he's going to try. Flashes burn. First blood to Mako. Ryu now. He's in trouble. That's going to force the flash out as well. Yannin going to keep moving in, and Pwn does get slowed. They are going to still rip Pwn. He flashes with the E. Ryu barely lives as Yannin now caught out in the top left there of the map. Ryu, he's going to keep going. Clear up. Flashes for him. What's the last kill? Amazing J not in range, and it's just one.
Pretty much everybody blowing their flash on both sides except for Lulix. There's only one flash.
Yannin.
But man, usually when you're talking about level ones, you're so scared of the team with Braum, because if you catch somebody out, the chase potential with Braum is ridiculous. But Annie starting Incinerate, charging up the stun from the fountain and getting there in time.
AoE stun. AoE knockup from Rek'Sai, because Braum passive is really good. If Yarn's E actually exploded on the entire team, that is a massive amount of damage. This was so incredibly close to being multiple kills on actually either side, but EDG, bloodthirsty support, though I would be proud, Mako picks up the kill.
Okay, so the silver lining there for H2K is that they do get back to lane first, and they can quickly shove it. Misses only one. yep. melee minion there.
And after that, we kind of expected a land swap. Instead, got a full-on 5v5. We actually do have standard lands, but just flip them around here. As we
no, we're swapping.
Yeah, oh, yeah. H2K, because they got their first, shove the lane very quickly, and they're going to piece out.
No flash on Pawn.
Oh, Pawn could be in trouble. Does get tag. Ryu going to keep moving in. There's one more. Does get the stun, but it's not enough to pick up a kill.
Yeah, and honestly, this Kassadin in lane in the early stages is just trying to hold his own here. So, you know, any chunk of health that you do take off of him could result in extra tower pressure from the mid lane.
And if you look at the top lane right now, both EDG members kind of backing off, and this is why we see Oduwamne going for early teleport. Only gets two creeps, though. Could have done that a little bit earlier. Amazing J was very low on a Darius from the double jungling so far, so slightly propelled forward. Tempo advantage usually here for H2K.
Alright, gonna use the teleport to the minion just to
deny some CS.
Exactly. Try and zone off Oduwamne there. Amazing J getting in place. Remember that they do have double teleports, EDG. They do have Pawn on Kassadin and with one as well. So side lanes still have to be worried.
Yeah, we were talking about how brutal that matchup is, Kalista and Annie, and we see H2K thinking about swapping again here. We immediately pushed in the wave with Tristana and Braum. They based, but I think they want to give the illusion that they're counter-swapping right now and then walking back to the bot lane. So some mind games going on here.
Certainly are, as Clearlove does leave his red buff. You can see things have quietened down a bit after the initial 5v5 fight. Just the first blood there. Actually, we're on to Mako, who's got a quick Ruby Crystal, likely for a fast sight soon.
Yeah, this is actually fairly scary for H2K here. With EDG getting out to an early lead and having the double teleport, there's so much pressure they can put on the map. Kassadin is the champion. The reason you take teleport on him is for the early teleports to the side lanes where you can pick up kills and start to snowball really early. So we see EDG, their Kalista any lane, try and shove in, then the Pawn teleport comes in and they try and snowball that early game.
Clearlove actually looking for a gank in mid. He knows that Ryu's flash isn't back, although he does have that ignite, but Pawn a little low on mana, gonna get aggressive. Nice trade though from Ryu in the mid lane.
I want to keep my eye here on Death and see what he maxes out on the Kalista. Very often in the Tristana matchup, you see Kalistas actually go for Q, so at least they can win the 1-2 auto-attack trades. Auto-attack Q, auto-hop out, and then pop a little E, because if you go for the E-max, then obviously you're stuck trading with a Tristana with Explosive Charge. You're not going to win that.
Exactly. Plus, you know, usually you're like, oh yeah, Tristana, she's so good into Kalista because her combo is front-loaded and she can get up a lot of bursts, but Annie landing the stun really interrupts that and messes with the timing of your trade.
Ooh, look at Lulex here.
Going aggressive. Clearlove actually may be forced out here. Good whap there by Gragas. But the Wolf helping out just a little. Clearlove gets away safely.
I mean, fraction of a second later means Lulex picks up that Wolf, chunks out Clearlove, and suddenly he is the one doing to Clearlove what Bengi did to him yesterday. So close.
He did get some deep vision down there, dropping the pink ward as well, and that's in a fairly rare spot to check, so that'll probably last a long time. Up in the top, though, trade going down.
Yeah, real aggressive. Nice riposte from Oduwamne, blocking that Q damage, I believe.
And that's what we're going to be seeing a lot in this matchup. Amazing J, obviously, once he starts casting that Q, it's going to come out, I think, 0.75 seconds later, and then obviously you can easily riposte that, but still got to do it. Oduwamne denies some damage there.
Yep, I'm trying to do something there on the top side. Amazing J, not too far behind his Pawn. Gonna clean out these waves. Trying to look, you know, get his farm. Got his flask. Looks like he's run out of charges, though, but he'll just clean up minions under turret as they shove towards him.
Oh, the Raptor buff gonna proc just as the ward is dying. Heartbreaking
junglers.
There for junglers. I know that feel, Lulex. He's had the small misses that just put you on tilt as a jungler. Just barely not getting the wolf on the invade. Then that as well. These small things add up, Crepo.
The collective sound of all the junglers in the crowd crying. No ignite here on Pawn. Luckily for Ryu, that's a flash.
Yeah, nice aggression there from Pawn, but couldn't quite finish it. Little low on mana, but starting to turn the matchup a bit.
This is actually huge. For Pawn on Kassadin to be able to turn this lane and gain control of mid lane, now he's level 6 also. He does have the teleport that we mentioned. This is so much pressure for EDG.
And now Clearlove actually trying to invade. Lulex was sick of him in his jungle. We'll go for the Grump. He should be able to smite this away. Are we going to have a battle? No, Lulex just completely backs off Pawn. Still too much of a threat.
Yeah, his turret is at just as much health as Ryu's is. He's leading in CS as Kassadin. He's buying the early Blasting Wand as well. Things are looking very good for Pawn and the rest of EDG.
Yeah, you really want to punish that Kassadin levels 1-5 and then use the advantage either to kill him in lane or use the fact that Lu is constantly pushing him to chip away at the tower, make a roam happen, but H2K didn't manage to do anything of all that sorts. Now Pawn is comfortably ahead in that matchup. Took a look at Deft as well. He is, in fact, maxing E because the laning phase is just going so unchallenged. So for objectives later, long out team fights, definitely in Deft's advantage.
And all that's actually led EDG to a nice little 1,000 gold up here at about 7.5 minutes in, so nothing massive at all as Mako is going to clear out that deep pink ward. Mako very vigilant when it comes to cleaning out vision and also placing vision for his team.
Oh, look at Hjarnan as well. He had the base picked up an early Avarice, even though he's on 51 CS, which is almost a BF sword mark, because he had a couple early bases for a long sword, some potions. Couldn't find himself some gold enough for a BF sword. Didn't want to get the pickaxe, so he's stuck on an Avarice. He is very far down in damage if it comes to a 2v2 skirmish.
Meanwhile, Mako's getting a lot of work done here. This is the dangerous line of wards to get in. This 7-minute mark is the most dangerous time for supports, and he just got down some very deep vision inside the back of that red buff. You can see there all through this bottom side jungle, which is what they're prepping for the big move. The Annie Kalista about to hit level 6. They do have both teleports ready as well. This means that EDG will see any jungler presence coming.
And that makes Lulex's life so hard. And very often we and many others criticize Lulex for not getting anything done, but his team isn't ever helping here. Always get that deep vision in his jungle. Uncontested jungle invades by Klealoth here, and Lulex slowly falls behind, and then the lane starts suffering because more pressure comes out of Klealoth.
And that's exactly what they want here. Klealoth, we've talked about his Rek'Sai. It's a champion that he's so proficient on. It just fits his skill set so well. So you know the gold lead, not really there yet for EDG, but the game playing out how they would like it. You can see Bilgewater Cutlass finish her death nice and early on. We've got the phase building up for Amazing J. And on, you know, on either side, just getting their components up. And we'll see what happens maybe 10 to 12 minutes in for that potential first dragon fight.
Yeah, it is so crucial to get some extra AD damage on that Tristana if you really want to burst out Deft in a couple of stuns, and there's... I don't see any realm of possibility where they win the 2v2, so pressure in bot lane from EDG, pressure in the mid lane now from some really nice trades on pawn from EDG, so everything going their way.
Yeah, for HGK on their side though, at least, you know, Odoamne was getting pressure on top side. He would shove up, and then he came down just a second before to try and help Lulex here. They saw this invade coming,
so
they're trying to collapse on Klealoth.
Klealoth got the blue though, now points here, he's got the Rift Walk in, gonna go in for Lulex. Ryu ults himself, but Klealoth flashes in for the Umbaru. Great casting, ignites good, Ryu's gonna get it, but Porty's still chasing. Odoamne, he's come down, Porty's barely gonna live as Odoamne challenges him and wins. Now Amazing J gonna chase himself down.
And the ultimate there from Odoamne, fully healed Ryu, he's coming in to back him up.
Amazing.
There's no way he can get away.
Through. The slow's there as well, just on the edge. Ryu's gonna go for Odoamne, claims the kill.
The number one point we said for HUK, protecting Lulex's jungle, they did it here. The early collapse there, Odoamne having shoving the lane, having priority in topside, and they're able to make Klealoth pay for coming in and stealing that blue.
And Pawn really wanted that kill. He left Klealoth alone, Ryu managed to kill him, then Pawn comes back in, gets hexed, and that gives enough time for Odoamne to come in. So greedy player by EDG finally punished, and a good collapse from HGK. That's what we want to see more of in this game.
Yeah, great response, and too aggressive by Klealoth. I didn't think he was going to go straight for the Umbaru. That's exactly what happened, and paid the price for trying to steal that blue. Back in the bottom lane though, as we calm things down. Deft and Mako still farming away. Deft actually building a nice CS lead, 20 up so far over Hjarnan.
Yeah, it was definitely touch and go there for a while with Pawn Get coming in on the Kassadin. Pretty big impact, but man, the healing on the Grand Challenge definitely underestimated. And they're able to chase them out of H2K territory. But again, they're still behind, even after that. That's just a small victory for H2K.
Yeah, but one of their two damage sources is propelled forward. Look at the TM had already finished on Odoamne, so he's now 2-0-0. If you get the lead in any of these Juggernaut matchups, it tilts so far in your one of the people's favor. Either you push and roll, but Lulex...
Lulex in trouble, gets bursted down. Klealoth cleans up an easy one.
So dangerous to go by yourself here, trying to ward, and EDG catch him out. Three man, they do not hesitate to burn everything. That's going to be Dragon as well. So, very quickly after the single win there from H2K, and EDG strike back.
Oh, now Pawn actually chasing out Ryu. Not quite enough to finish it, but gonna pressure him away as EDG do take Dragon number one.
And that's just so sloppy. You have double pink wards. You don't need to get that green ward ahead of it unless you actually spot people. Early move from Lulex, and that is something we see very often, even in Europe from H2K, is that they ward on their own. They may be in the vicinity of each other, whether it's Lulex and Kasing, but they don't really synergize well. They don't back each other up, and that's exactly what you need. Now we see Odoamne.
Nice play, that's pop the ulti. Amazing J gonna pull him in for it. Odoamne, can he outplay the duck? He's good! Repulsed it, and manages to live!
Clutch riposte right there from Odoamne, and yet, he still has to leave because Rek'Sai could easily come. Oh wow, he actually canceled his recall. He's looking to shove another wave here with the Tiamat.
but I think
luckily for him, you know, Clearlove's not around.
Not just yet. Isoto Omne might finish that one off, but I think we can start to see the matchup. You know, it's very back and forth. Amazing Grey's played it once before and did pick up a win, but can start to see where Fiora can get an edge in that particular 1v1.
Oh, and poor Hyona, so he base first, picked up the Avarice because he couldn't afford the BF sword and he didn't want the pickaxe. Picked up the pickaxe anyways. It's going downhill in that bot lane.
Well, top lane could be very interesting.
EDG saw Ulic sink into that bush.
Good vision there. You can see a little bit of movement from the Tremor Sense. Clearlove wants to be the one to come in second, I believe. He's going to spot Lulex here, and they're all back away.
Yeah, I think they were thinking about setting up a trap there with the pawn teleport, but Ryu is putting a lot of pressure on mid lane, shoving him into the turret with a quick wave clear.
Clearlove is here in mid, but just going to find a pink ward instead. Ryu looking good, building in towards that Athene's Rod of Ages on the way for pawn. Both those mid laners should have the major items completed relatively quickly. It's Amazing Jay. Think he knows what's up, but I don't know if he can stop this potential dive.
Seeing a very extended laning phase here. So far, not much cross map moving, not too many roams. And I think a style we see very often in the LPL, but that's also a style H2K like playing. They're very accustomed to that. Especially in the later parts of the season, they stepped away from that very lane swap focused meta where they focused on the 10 to 20 and they just did the 0 to 10, 0 to 15. So overall, they can still come back from that deficit, especially if we can get to some more item spikes here. Some rough points due to the early game.
And pace of the game, not really going maybe as chaotic as we expected. It started with that big 5v5 at level 1, but it's just been some solid landing, some good ganks and invades by both sides here. And actually in bottom lane, H2K going to get the first turret of this game. They will take bot tower. Clearlove is not nearly enough to defend that.
Yeah, Tristana easily going to be able to take that one out. Let's see where they send him next, because Odoamne right now from base could swap lanes, but he's heading straight back to the matchup with Amazing Jay.
Yeah, Pawn has an advantage in items, but it does take time for that Rod of Ages to scale up, and then compared to the Athene's immediate power spike on Lulu in mid lane, get some magic resistance so the poke from Palm doesn't really hurt. He can consistently clear mid lane first, so he always has the first step in that mid lane. Ryu here, so maybe you can soon see him roam a little bit. If he can get up top, Lulu is so good with and against the Juggernauts. That's why her value has even gone up in these tournaments and will almost always see her as a guaranteed first pick.
Yeah, I feel like EDG just have so much control though, because Clearlove was able to farm a bit more efficiently than Lulex in the early stages when they were, you know, moving around top. He got an early sight zone here, and the Ninja Tabby actually very effective. He's going in.
Yeah, collapse here onto Kasing. Mokom's going to be there from the face call. Mako does line up the stun. Unbreakable. Not enough. Deft is going to get the kill. And now actually the chase on Lulex could be in trouble. Ulti used. And to clear the pink ward.
This is exactly what we talked about earlier. Lulex and Kasing, yeah, they were on the same screen, but they're not backing each other up. Look at Clearlove and Mako. They were in the same brush, clearing vision together, engaging together, knock up into stun. That synergy is completely lacking in H2K, and it will be their downfall.
Clearlove and Mako work so well together. Plus, Clearlove is really using the Void Rush for more uptime on the map. Ryu here
on.
Just gets Portis soloed.
Polly's there. Wildgrunt comes out as well. Pawn has to flash. Riff walks away. Teleport's been used. But here's the follow from Amazing Jay. He wants it up, but he's been challenged by Fiora. Odoamne gonna run into Sianna, goes through. Huge double apprehend, flushes out of the way. Clearlove's here as well. He's popped in with the ulti, and now Mako flash ult, max range damage. Odoamne goes down to Amazing Jay, and Hyannon, he will continue the chase. Clearlove hungry for blood. He has his flash, he uses it straight onto Hyannon. The ult there from Brom, sorry, the Q from Brom, not enough, and they'll keep chasing Hyannon. He needs the rocket jump up, but he's gonna get it. Clearlove, no chase. Can he get the kill? He will!
And that's gonna mean some extra time in here to steal away the blue buff, possibly. They do have Sightstone as well, they can just drop wards over the side, so blue buff steal on top of it. That could also mean pressure on top turret. A lot gain there for EDG, collapsing very quickly into the mid lane.
And we're really starting to see what it does to a Kassadin if he gets untouched in terms of pressure, and he can just farm up 10 CS per minute, roughly, if is the goal you want as a mid laner. Pawn right now sitting at 0.6, 0.7 of that, so really, really getting farmed up. His Rod of Ages stacking. Look at the damage already on Ryu. Ryu is forced to ulti, but Pawn, he makes it out alive.
Yeah, so Pawn able to get a lot of damage done, and then the flash riftwalk, as you said, to evade Odoamne, even though Odoamne got the first teleport into the fight.
And then that jump from Hyannon barely does it, so Amazing Jay makes it flashed out, and obviously the turret zoning out in that fight makes Hyannon's life so rough. And then Mako, again, flash timbers, that is bread and butter when he plays Annie. For me, whenever Mako picks Annie, I have this vision of a four-man timber stun. That's what he really excels at later in the game, and hopefully we'll get to see more of that.
Yeah, Clearlove able to get right in there and get the knock-up on Harnin to stop him as well. And as you know, He ends with a death.
So close for Tristana to get away, but a very aggressive and a trademark aggressive flash from Clearlift to secure it. Bottom tower did go down as well, so EDG do pick up a tower. H2K, though, still ahead in that metric, 2-1 in towers. One up in EDG for Dragons. This one's back alive, so they might be able to get it, and still up in gold for Edward Gaming.
Yeah, they should be able to secure this fairly easily. Deft on Kalista, so far ahead. You kept on checking in with the build there from Yharnam. A traditional, you know, Infinity Edge rush AD carry, being behind versus the Kalista is just so, so frustrating for H2K right now.
Timmis is down, Lulex is in trouble, does die to pawn. Now gonna keep running. No, do they want the dive? The stun does not hit. EDG just gonna shove mid instead.
And this complete map control in terms of vision and pressure is really making H2K break apart, really. They're trying to move up, but every time they move even near the river, Mako and Angler are already in unison.
This tower looks to fall now as EDG is going to shove some spears into it. H2K doing a nice job defending. Clearlove does back away from it all. Looks like the top laners are pulled down as well.
As you can see, even with the lead, still fairly difficult for them to take turrets. Ryu on the Lulu does have very good wave clear when backed up by Tristana, even with Tristana having no items.
And I wonder when EDG is actually going to start playing this game as a 1v1. They have a double teleport on their mid laner and a top laner. Both their top laner and their mid laner are really good in 1v1 scenarios. It's impossible to solo kill a Kassadin because he only fights if he wants to, and he can pressure you in that side lane with the mobility, with the teleport. It's going to be incredibly hard for H2K, whose composition relies around grouping so much, to get out of that split push.
Yeah, the one strength for H2K has been Odoana in the top lane on the Fiora. He's been their point of power. That's the only reason that their top lane outer turret is still standing.
You can see the items, honestly, for both sides starting to come out. We've got the Hydro down for Odoamne, but the Black Cleaver there. I think we're just going to have a fight. Odoamne does pop the ulti, but Clearlove is here. They are going to come in, but I don't know if it's enough. He'll get pulled back in. The teleport from Pawn, amazing day. Already too low. Heal does go up. He hits the vitals, but he does die as Odoamne dashes back in. There'll be a trade. There are now Ryu caught out in the top side. Kasing trying to make it happen. Lulex here, but Mako and Death already up. Collapsing so well are EDG as they'll keep running through. Fates called down. Double tip and stun. Death gets the neck till Clearlove finds a knockup. Yharnam coming in, but he doesn't have enough damage. He'll keep diving straight through. Great buster shot from Yharnam to save it, but Def hopping man around the turrets, and they're still going. EDG, they want the last, they will not get it.
Def hops out the tower.
Oh, me and Krepo both hands on our heads after that skirmish from the bottom lane of EDG. What a great play.
But where was Yharnam? That entire fight was 5v4 until Yharnam joined them on their tower. Fantastic buster shot. You would think Def would die, but then Def just hops out, uses Lulex as an escape. That's what Lulex has deterred to right now. He's being used as a vessel to get out of that tower range. Def still zero deaths here, and he's getting ready to carry this guy.
Plus, the timing on that counter engage from Death and Mako, where he uses the Kalista ultimate right into Ant. All right, we'll take a look at it here, because Odoamne does do a good job chunking down the vitals. He's going to actually
so proc here
the healing, and that's almost enough because Ryu made the first roam, but again, teleport from Pawn, he's there as well.
Yeah, if he could have just killed Amazing Day immediately, used that Q on Pawn, maybe the fight could get different. But look at your minimap. Death and Mako are already zoning Yharnam, so he's taking the long route around, and then look at him, throw in your Tibbers. Your Annie, then throw the Tibbers, Ryu gets stunned, so beautiful 1-2 combo every time by EDG here.
Then everybody thinks Deft is dead here with that knockback, but he goes with the heal, barely gets out of range of Blue Licks and secures another one.
And again, classic Deft popping the summoner spells just when he needs them with that heal as EDG starts a rocket ahead as far as gold goes. Now 5,000 gold up in this particular game. Well, we've talked about the items from H2K. They've got at least one major item on most of their players, but EDG have at least two.
Yeah, Deft right now, he's got the Runon's plus Blade of the Ruin King power spike on Kalista combo, even upgraded boots, whereas it's just the Infinity Edge for Yharnam.
And then Avarice with 400 gold.
Okay, there your Avarice that you've kept your eye on all game.
I hate that item, personally. I think it just delays the builds way too often, and you're better off just getting early power, especially in a non-BF versus BF matchup. BF pickaxe into Cutlass can actually be the breaking point of this matchup. H2K didn't manage to read it. Props to Deft and Mako, though, for playing around. Their synergy has been on point, so much synergy pairing within that team. Deft and Mako, Clearlove and Mako, top side of the map. Everybody works as a team, as opposed to H2K, very fractured.
Right, and the plan going forward for EDG, since we mentioned, you know, their weakness in taking the turrets and straight up sieges, since all the outer turrets are down right now, it's just about Operation Wardline. Can they get them deep inside the red jungle, prepare for this dragon? They've got a minute and 30 seconds ahead. They can allow the split push with that vision as well. It's a 2-for-1, so they can pressure mid lane and bottom lane. They're doing it exactly right now. Very deep vision. And they're looking to draw H2K out into the map.
Yeah, exactly what we talked about. Look at Pawn here in the bottom lane. Just starting to push. He's so strong and clear love. Even ready with the ulti or just there right now in case he needs him. Pjanic, and he's going to go a bit aggressive, but Pawn more than happy to fight.
And Pawn, after just getting the Phoenix Codex for cooldown reduction, went straight into the Zhonya's. That allows you to go extremely aggressive in the teamfights because you don't have to wait for the Rift Walk while taking damage. Up at top, though, another duel.
Nice bait, actually, by Amazing Jay. He knows his team is coming. Odoana goes a little too far, perhaps, but the team is running around the wrong side. Def going to start to hop off the Krogs, but Odoana looks to be safe.
That was actually a good reaction by Odoana. The second he heard Rek'Sai scream, he knew that he was getting collapsed upon, especially since mid lane was entirely dark, and then the safest path is actually charging at your closest enemy. That's how you beat flanks, you collapse on them, but Ryu is caught in the mid lane.
Collapsed anyway. Pawn getting aggressive, clear up, trying to line up a knockup. He does have his flash. Look for him to use it as Pawn now. Gonna move in, they'll get the knockup, they'll chase Kasing. He's not dead. Mako, yes, will pick the kill up, just barely though.
Yeah, that entire act right there from H2K was just every man for himself trying to get out alive because Kjarnan's not there. There's nowhere he can make it. He's just trying to push as hard as he can while EDG are going to take this Baron. I don't think H2K should even get close because there it is.
Oh my god, they've gone in onto Ryu. Damage out there. Q will land from Pawn and it's an EDG special. They get one pick straight to Baron.
Yeah, I don't know what you're going to do there for H2K. They already had lost one member. Now it looks like they're losing another.
Throwing Mako.
They got him off Baron though.
They did. Odoamne, nice moves there as Pawn's trying to chase Lulex. He has caught him as we move back in. Def gonna get the arrows out there. Slow is good. Pawn will collect it.
EDG playing with the necessary amount of respect. They know the only way to really lose this game at this point is lose a Baron and maybe two kills. They just hunt the jungler, hunt the top laner. They almost get Odoamne there, but I think he reposted an Annie Q stun and just walked out of there. So EDG don't get Baron, but they're still in full control. Kobe talked about that vision earlier. They're just setting it up consistently and then using their aggressive gap closers to really, really find these favorable fights.
Yeah, talking about drawing H2K out into the open, that was the very center of the map. And EDG did not waste any time. This dragon definitely should be forfeit here from H2K. EDG are going to take it. Unless Kasing can have a magical... No? All right.
Trip does try it, but will not connect as the dragon number three will in fact go to EDG. Gold lead starting to really stack up now. 7,500 gold as H2K will respond. Should be able to get this tower. EDG caught backing here. So a nice little move there from H2K. Def's even going to clear some things out. Very strong. His next shop will be a big one here. Going to go back and spend a whole bunch of money. And you can see EDG just getting stronger and stronger across the board.
Yeah, Def sitting on 2,000 gold, and that's exactly what separates him from Kjarnan. So Def alone is 2,000 gold ahead of his lane opponent. Tracking the top laners, Odoamne is actually the only person, I believe, ahead of his direct opponent. Odoamne has 8.5k gold acquired this entire game, 7.7k here for Amazing J. So that's the saving grace.
Credit where credit is due to Odoamne. Our questions about the Fiora-Darius matchup have been answered. Definitely he did have an advantage, and even in the face of a lot of extra team pressure from EDG, he's done quite well for himself. It just has not been enough. That one bastion of hope for H2K up in the top lane has run out. Turret's gone down.
Yeah, very big gold discrepancies too, just between Klilov and Mako as a pair compared to Lulex and support Kasing there, and you can really feel that in the game as well. Vision is more efficient for EDG, it gets placed deeper, EDG works better around it. H2K feels like they're drowning, they're clawing to get back into the game, and Odoamne alone will have an incredibly hard time getting them back into it.
And speaking of that vision, EDG with the dragon down, doing what they really love to do, try and get vision around that Baron. They've taken the Rift Scuttler, actually. No trouble there for Klilov, does tunnel his way to safety.
H2K's composition does excel when they group. That could be the one angle they're looking for, you know, group up, you know, Jugger Tristana, call it what you want, Lulu plus X does very well in many scenarios, especially when you're grouped.
Yeah, they do want a bit more crit chance from Kjarnan. Here comes the teleport.
Yeah, Pawn actually flanking in now, goes straight in onto Kjarnan, knows what he wants, gonna look for a wild growth. His burnt Mako does land the stun. Kjarnan not going to leave as Mako picks up his third kill. And now EDG gonna do exactly what they do at this time, run straight to Baron. H2K have two bad choices now.
Yeah, and this is the way you play division game. Stun here on Lulex.
Pawn back in. Lulex knocked up there. Oh, Bromov from Kasing will not save his teammate Pawn. Gonna keep jumping back in. They'll just chase here as Kasing gets mowed down by Kassadin.
EDG's just leaving poor choices for HTK. What do you want? Face check and die, or face check and lose, or don't face check and lose Baron? And there's no way to win that decision tree here. Good patience from EDG and vision control paying off yet again.
The vision control has been such a steady story for EDG, and their use of True Sight, upgrading the double Oracles, so many pink wards purchased for them as well. They actually dropped the most wards per minute yesterday of any of the teams. Yes, it's only a single game though.
One game sample size, boys.
Plus, it was a dominating win for them, so it does make it fairly easy.
But yeah, Mako, he's right now is tied in kills with the entire H2K lineup. Generally, doesn't bode well.
He has unlocked the Bloodthirst. Like we mentioned, Doa is going to be happy. Pawn will keep clearing some stuff out. He's going to take the Grump away. But again, the gold lead now ballooned almost completely out of control. EDG almost 10,000 gold ahead.
Yeah, this is one of the few times we see Righteous Glory still being built on this patch. Mako going for just a very offensive Annie. Distortion Boots, Righteous Glory, just all you have to do is close the gap. If you can't get there, Death will give you a little nudge. Just get that stun down and your team should have enough damage to follow up.
Yeah, I've got a question for you, Mr. Support Main. How do you feel about selling the Spell Thieves and going coin to upgrade into the Talisman instead of going Righteous Glory, since Righteous Glory was nerfed and Talisman is so efficient now? Are you a fan of that path?
I think.
Or do you like the extra beefiness that Righteous gives you? It is a longer cooldown
as
well.
The benefit of Talisman is that you can both disengage and engage, since Righteous Glory already works on offensive movement.
More cooldown.
However, EDG have no plans of disengaging this game.
They're
just going to go straight on forward. And Mako, all he needs to do is survive for potential and extra stun rotation. So in this game, in this particular case, extra health, extra beefiness is all he needs. His job is only to go in, potentially create his life for others.
Yeah.
But EDG is killing HTK so fast that Mako doesn't even die in these fights.
Yeah, and they've taken that bottom turret as well. Getting very close to 10,000 gold ahead. Look at Mako on Pawn. Maybe even posturing for a dive. They'll line it up. They've got the Baron buff. EDG, very efficient once they get Baron. They usually close the game out from this spot.
Yeah. EDG are like, they're like a hipster with a fixie bike instead. You don't need... You're only going one direction. You don't need brakes either.
Well, we're going to try and knock down some more turrets. Odawamne feeling tricky. But Amazing J is going to shrug off that ulti. The rest of his team's there. They'll knock down this turret in the top lane as the tier 2 falls. It's 5 turrets now for EDG.
Yeah, this item point is where Darius hits like phase 2 and it becomes so hard to deal with. And Deadman's Blade gives him so much innate mobility and tankiness. On top of that Black Cleaver that works so efficiently, and no more 1v1 potential for Odawamne. H2K is already... They're starting to lose the group fights, and then Lulu compositions become in very, very peril territory.
Yeah, I mean, we can touch on the builds. The massive extra gold definitely helps out a lot for EDG. They're going to just bully this turret
now. Lilith actually stunned. He's taking a lot of damage, but they take the turret. Clear up. We'll still live. Odawamne, an amazing day, having a brawl on the backside. Def will get a kill, though, onto Gragas. They'll take the tower, take the kill. That's all the tier 2 turrets dead now.
And again, Rek'Sai can just ultimate right back onto the field. They've got the Baron-powered recall. There's just so much map control with this squad. Easily going to be able to pick up this dragon as well. Complete control here for EDG.
Yeah, that is the advantage that 2 teleports and a Rek'Sai jungle bring to you in terms of tempo. Every time you base, you can start the action so much quicker than the other team because you can get back there, set up for dinner. You're actually too early.
Yeah,
that's important. You're just too quick.
People make fun of the farm alarm from Rek'Sai, and they're like, oh yeah, she's just getting back out on the map to farm. She doesn't do anything. No, that's huge. That's how Clearlove got such a good early advantage in experience and gold and got to the early sight stone. It's a domino effect. Uh-oh, Ryu.
Someone's in trouble. It's Ryu. Mako does stun him up there. Ryu's already used his splash. Def gonna keep hopping away. Amazing Day's the next one. Doesn't even need the dung.
Thank you very much.
Def says, Mako, I choose you. I want to kill here, but goes on Amazing Day in the end. Yeah, EDG, prime position to close. Let's see how efficiently you can do it, because that's what you got to look at when you have tournament favorites in group stages. How efficiently can they close? What will they give away in the later stages of this match?
H2K, you can see getting a bit creative now, trying to camp out a brush, because running out of options here as EDG are well and truly ahead, about 13,000 gold here in this game. H2K can still fight back. They'll be back in their base and see what they can collect here. But EDG very rarely lose a game when they're ahead, and they have carved out a very large lead for themselves in this particular game.
Indeed they have, and they can just continue to push all lanes at once to keep H2K bottled up inside their base. they can keep them bottled up inside their base so long that the wards actually time out on the map. So they don't even have to run around searching for the wards and trying to clear them. And then they could just starve them out.
And that is some way of how we've been tracking these teams. Hang on, we'll get to that stat later.
Pawn 1v2, ulted by Odoamne. Who's down here? Dakyanan as well. Pawn already popped the Zonya's Braum Pressive on him. He's going to try and get out of it. Riftwalk after the flash. Needs a stun. Does land it. Walk is there. Get a Riftwalk again. Bloomer making this so hard. Ariya's dead on the other side of the map. And Pawn, he looks to make the greatest.
Pawn
pops a teleport. It's not enough to shut down out of Kissing.
Ah, here come the... spamming
up. Deft has got another kill. EDG, in the meantime, breaking the base apart.
Our stats guys do so much work to bring us the Baron power play. Say, hey guys, look at this. And then Pawns are diving in 1v3 blind into brushes. Two towers down, two Nips about to fall.
Yeah, you know he was like, there's probably one person in this brush, right?
Maybe two at best. Dives in.
Does pick the fight, does lose it unfortunately, but EDG clean out HQK's base. Two inhibs down now, many, many structures fallen, and a huge amount of kills. They'll even steal the blue buff just on the way out.
Yeah, we see EDG retreat to Baron area right now, starting the vision up, and that's some way we've been tracking the way these teams have been closing out games. Is there efficiency with Baron? Call that the Baron power play. Let's see how Ryu meets his demise here against Amazing J.
Brush trick of their own for EDG. Amazing J with the one-man fanatic brush.
That was so much damage onto poor Lulu.
Slam dunk.
Yeah, this is my favorite build once you get to this point for Darius. He just has all of the answers. So much move speed. He has the tenacity to back it up. And then even if you start doing damage to him and you try and take him down, he just kills you that much faster. Steryx, the only problem with it is that you can't buy it on non-Juggernauts. I was so excited when I saw Juggernaut items coming out. I was like, yeah, I'm gonna play Vine, you know, get my... But on Juggernaut Champions, it is extremely good.
And you can see EDG still vigilant about that vision control as Mako clears out a ward. They can, you know, wait around for the next Baron or Dragon if they want to. And EDG, very respectful, not making any huge... moves, not overplaying, just playing safe. They know they've got the game locked up.
Yeah, I don't think EDG has space tech to single brush this game.
What are you talking about? Pawn just freaking rift walked into the brush with two people in it.
Is it a face tech if you actually rift walk in teleportation?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I yield. I think EDG this game has only face tech one.
Mr. Force Bolt.
just Cassidy himself. As EDG do line themselves up
like
for this next
turn. The manliest face tech of all time.
I yield. You win, Kobe. You win.
EDG now are gonna take this.
Okay, it would have been better if he flashed into it.
Dude, I agree.
Alright, yeah, you're right, Pastry. Keep us on track. They're taking the Baron. That's gonna be the tool that they use to actually end the game.
I don't think we'll be able to track another Baron power play because the game will be over, I think, before this Baron buff expires.
Does Nexus not give you bonus points for a Baron power play?
50 gold?
Yeah, 50 gold. That's true. That is the technical worth as Amazing J.
I don't feel like that accurately represents the gravity the of taking a Nexus, but...
I mean, it doesn't compare to an Avarice plate, let's face it.
Oh my. As EDG now grouping up here. They've got the Baron. Remember, they've only got one inhibitor left that they can take, and they will group together in the bottom side. Amazing J, very slick moves there out on the court. They are just going to move in and try and finish this the easy way.
Keep your eyes on Mako.
Okay. Always. He does love to get aggressive, him and Clear Love. We talked about that synergy. He'll do everything, including flashing straight at the enemy AD carry. HGK have already given this in here, but I don't know if they can even stop this.
I mean, this is a mental forfeit right here. Instead of typing slash FF, they're just letting them finish.
Yeah, Kissing now going to get aggressed on that. Damage is massive. Wild Growth, not nearly enough to save it as Death picks up his sixth kill.
I like how HGK have such a good attitude, though. Kissing smiling, just spamming his emote as he charges in there.
You can see some flashes being burnt. EDG will take out the remaining turret to get on the Nexus. Then he wants some more kills. Mako went straight into the fountain on that one. And Deft is still firing away. Odoamne will challenge Deft to a duel. Can he win it? Won't matter as the Nexus explodes. And EDG, a very clean win as they undefeated after two games.
Clean, definitely the name of the game for EDG. So much control over the map from the early stages of the game. Clear Love using that Rek'Sai, working with Mako to set up their vision.
We're still waiting for that SKT EDG to really confirm who's going to take number one and number two.
Tomorrow, my friend, tomorrow. First game.
Going to be a massive game for sure. We've seen both
SKT and EDG stay undefeated in this group. They're expected to come out, you know, out of this group as the top two teams. I guess the only question is which order, and we're at least going to get a glimpse at it tomorrow once they do take to the Rift. But EDG, another strong win, very similar comp. Don't show too much here, and they'll pick up another win for themselves.
And Older Wamnet involved in 4 out of H2K's 5 kills. One kill that I believe he wasn't involved in was that manly face check from Khan, so it doesn't count. Involved in all the important kills here, and he played well, but H2K as a whole just outmatched.
Yeah, certainly looks that way as EDG pick themselves, like we said, a nice clean win. But H2K, you know, tough game certainly to start your World Championship. It's going to be a tough group for those two teams. They had to play SKT and EDG back to back. So H2K still have, you know, movement here in this group for sure. But yeah, it was always going to be a tough start to your World Championships.
Yeah, they knew what they were in for. As soon as the group try, you know, the top end of this group is so heavy for them. Coming into it, though, you know, and trying to attack EDG from the very beginning.
They started
with their invade. It's just EDG had the Annie Stun charged up ready for that invade. And, you know, starting off on the back foot like that for H2K really took a lot of wind out of their sails.
Yeah, they started out. A couple of things could have maybe went better. You know, Luix dashes over, perhaps seeking the deny clear of some farm, but then slowly it starts coming down. And yeah, the synergy mismatches is the biggest thing that I take away from this game.
Well, for a deeper dive into EDG's in, we're going to check in with our crack team of analysts.
Thank you, gentlemen. We're going to start off with the picks and bans, because we saw the all-important Lulu fall over to the side of H2K, but we also got to see the Fiora-Darius matchup in the top lane and Kassadin making a showing here at the world stage.
I feel definitely like H2K had a really good draft in response of the Darius, had a kite composition, but what I wanted to see them do is put the Fiora in the mid lane against the Kassadin and then just pretty much put the Lulu on top against Darius.
I actually think both are fine matchups, though, because the Fiora can just go ahead and queue in every time that the Darius charges up the Decimate, and then you're able to not give him the heal, and then the Lulu just auto-attack harasses the Kassadin during the laning phase. So I think they're actually both fine matchups, but maybe that one was optimal, because I do like Fiora into Kassadin early game, and they didn't punish it enough.
I really don't like it when EDG plays Kassadin. This is one of my biggest beefs with EDG, and they play Kassadin about as well as you can, but with this kind of scaling that Kassadin needs. And what happened here is EDG picked a composition with virtually no wave clear. Mm. And this was just not at all punished by H2K. Now, EDG gets away with Kassadin a lot of the time by having Clearlove just standing in a brush in mid lane, waiting to counter gank and trying to force a 2v2 when pawn has to push forward to recall. But I just don't like their overemphasis on this particular champion, and I think a good team will punish this. So it makes me nervous to see EDG play it. Even though they play it about as well as you can, there's still some serious flaws, especially after that level one. There were a lot of missed opportunities from H2K.
Level one, Zyrene, talk to me about that, because there was a lot that happened in a couple minutes.
Yeah, I thought it was an intelligent decision by both sides. H2K, I look at their comp. I go, okay, I have Lulu, I have Braum, and they have a Kassadin. Of course I want to invade on them. But then EDG says, well, of course they want to invade on us. They all stack up. Mako charges the stun, multi-man stun, and then they end up getting a kill. But they blow 5 flashes to do that. And that's the big part for me, because it's 5 flashes for 1 kill, and Lulex does nothing. And he has his flash up for the next 5 minutes when nobody else on the enemy team does. Go to a lane, body slam flash Kassadin, body slam flash your top laner. Do something with that summoner spell. Get your team a little bit of an advantage, because they used too much for 1 kill.
And I think the worst thing about that was it was Kasing who was on Braum trying to gank. Why can't they work together to just get the kill onto the flashless Kassadin? I mean, it's like appallingly basic professional League of Legends, and nothing was done about it. It's almost unfathomable. And I mean, Lulex's scoreline at this end of this game, 0-8-2.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's enough said
there. He spent most of this game living in a jungler's paradise. I mean, you, as a jungler, everyone's flash is gone. My God, there's a Kassadin in the mid lane. Get in there.
Yep. Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely. Now, on the flip side, though, a player that I want to point out for having played a pretty terrific game of League of Legends would be Clearlove, his counterpart on the other side of EDG.
I definitely feel like Clearlove in these team fights was showing up at the right time and executing perfectly. This is a great example of how he plays this fight out. He's skirting around, he's waiting for the opportunities, and then he just cuts him off, forces the flash out, and then the rest of it, you can take it from here if you guys want.
Well, just coming in right here, clearly it's going to follow up onto Hjarnen, and you're going to see him actually flash the Tristana ultimate in just a second. So coming in, getting another knock up onto Hjarnen, just beautiful awareness by Clearlove of the positioning, the cooldowns that are still up. Now, it did start a little bit questionable from H2K because they saw the teleport coming in. Odoamne had actually had the teleport priority, and I think they should have just turned back onto Amazing J's teleport location immediately instead of trying to chase the Kassadin, who was already chunked out of that fight. But Lulex didn't have any mana, so their ability to skirmish may have been a bit questionable, but I think they may have been able to turn and burst down Amazing J instead of trying to overcommit to the Kassadin.
Yeah, they did a lot of chasing of Kassadin here. Even in the bottom lane where Pod was able to riftwalk like four times and try to get away, they did a lot of chasing him around, but it was way too late in the game to do that. Chase him around level two, level three. Go after the guy in the mid lane that you need to exploit pre-6, and they did none of that.
It's like,
but yeah, Clearlove did a great job.
Speaking of the Kassadin, I think even though I don't think it was the perfect pick in this scenario, I think Kassadin is a pick that we should look out for because the buff is significant. And like, especially against the likes of Azir that we've seen a lot in this tournament.
Do you pick the Kassadin into a Lulu?
No. I would not. Never.
Because that was the last pick here, right?
They
to me, this is a very arrogant draft EDG. And this will bite them against a better team. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Would they do it? I don't know, but it's cocky.
Lucky to have it work this time. Might not be so lucky in the future. Well, with Group C done for today, let's see how the teams stack up. SKT are on top along with EDG, both teams 2-0. Meanwhile, BKT and H2K are in the bottom half 0-2.
And I think Mako is a big reason as to why they were able to win that game so handily as well. We talked about Clearlove, but Mako's performance on the Annie, stunning multiple people with every ultimate, using multiple stun Ws, and paired with Def's Kalista, we don't see a lot of Kalista from Def that's a good performance, but it enables Mako to make plays like that. And that's what I think is going to be a huge part when he's up against Wolf on SKT tomorrow.
Without a doubt, a huge playmaker for the team. Well, Group A is up next as the LMS's Flash Wolves face off against Korea's Ku Tigers. There's more Worlds coming your way right after this.
EDG likely coming at least somewhat favored, but H2K, a team that can certainly bring it. Gonna get a knockoff on the Cassine. They're gonna keep running his Def. He's hopping. He doesn't have that much damage, but he's gonna try. Flashes burn. First blood to Mako. Flashes out of the way. Clearlove's here as well. He's popped in with the ulti. And now Mako. Flash ult. Max range damage. Odoamne goes down to Amazing J coming in, but he doesn't have enough damage. He'll keep diving straight through. Great buster shot from Hjarnen to save it. But Def hopping man around the Taurus. Pod. He looks to make the greatest.
Pod
pops the teleport. It's not enough to shut down. A very clean win to stay undefeated after two games.